Saram children, in the previous video we have just discussed about the chapter number 1, that is computer system overview. So today it is the second part of the same chapter. Let's move forward in this chapter. What is there we are going to discuss today? So our today's topic is computer components and basic computer organization. So this topic we have started basically in the previous video. In that video we have discussed very first two topics, input unit and output unit. So basic components of computer system we have discussed, input unit and output unit. Today we are going to discuss about the rest components of this computer organization. Okay, so let's see what is the third component, central processing unit, CPU. So this word is very much familiar to you. You know that what is CPU, children? CPU is the brain of computer basically. Like in human being, we are having brain here. In the same manner, in computer or system, if we talk about CPU, is the brain of computer. Okay, so CPU or the central processing unit is the main control center and processing unit. CPU, we can say that as processor as well as. It is also called the brain of the computer. So let's see what is there in this. Let's move to the next slide. Central processing unit, it is also called the brain computer as it guides, directs, controls and governs the performance of the computer. Like whatever situation come in day-to-day life, children, so according to that you see that situation, you analyze that situation, according to that you take decision. Like if you want to go out, okay, and suddenly rainfall start, okay, so what do? You wait till that rainfall stops, or you manage something so that you are not able to wet. So this is the decision taken by your mind only. In the same manner, computer has brain too. So according to the situation only, it guides us, directs us, control and governs the performance. Okay, now CPU has some sub component as well as, like brain has some components, okay, subconscious mind, conscious mind. In the same manner, CPU is also having some sub components. Now this CPU is divided its work into three parts: arithmetic logical unit, control unit and register. Basically CPU is having only two components, ALU and CU, but in some books third component is also present. So in your book also third component, register, is present. So let's see how CPU has divided the full function work to these three components. So ALU is the first component. ALU perform all four arithmetic operations. Now you know that we are having basic arithmetic operations. What are they? Plus, minus, multiply, divide. So these are the basic arithmetic operations. So whenever such kind of thing, like if you want to add to number, if you want to subtract to number, if you want to multiply to number or divide to number, if such type of work you are giving to computer, so who will deal with such kind of operation? ALU, arithmetic logic unit. So as the name suggests, that arithmetic logical operation is dealt by the ALU only. Now when you are giving such problem, it is going to store in the memory of the computer first. Afterwards, memory shift this problem to the ALU. Now ALU solve this problem. Afterward, the whatever answer comes, it again going to store in the memory itself. Okay, now arithmetic logic unit, the second word is logic. Now it also deal with the logical operations. Okay, for logical operation also, numbers to be compared as sent from the memory to ALU. Now logical operation, what kind of operation we are having? Logical operation like greater than sign, smaller than sign, equal to, greater than equal to, smaller than equal to, so these kind of are the logical operators. So such type of operators basically we use for the comparison only, for the comparison only. So again, memory gives such kind of work to the ALU, then ALU performs such kind of operation, and whatever result is coming is again shift to the memory. Okay, now when the comparison take place, the result is returned to the memory. The result of the logical operation is true or false. So logical operations result come in the format of true or false only. These operation provide the capability of decision making to the computer. Okay. So this is the work of arithmetic logical unit. Now second component is control unit. Now what is control unit? We can also say that CU. The control unit controls and guides the interpretation and follow and manipulation of all the data and information. CU sends control signals until the required operation are done properly by ALU and memory. Like when memory shifting work to the ALU or ALU is returning to memory. So whether that work properly done or not is handled by CU only. Another important function of CU is program execution. That is carrying out all the instructions stored in the program. So whatever instructions we need to give to in the meanwhile of the program, all the instructions is carried by CU only. CU gets program instruction from memory and execute them one after the other children. After getting the instruction from the memory in CU, the instruction is decoded and interpreted which operation is to be performed. Then the ARX operation is carried out. After the work of this instruction is completed, control units send the signal to memory to send the next instruction in sequence to CU. Control unit even controls the flow of data from input device to memory or from memory to the input output device. So the mediator is between input and output. Like if we are giving input to the computer with the help of the keyboard, so the input given by you is taken by CU, then CU give instruction to the monitor, according to that output you are able to see. So the basically we can say that CU is the interpreter, or we can say that it is a mediator of any kind of communication. It manages all the functionality of computer system. It controls, it guides of all the computer. Like we are having three unit, basic units, input unit, output unit and ALU. So the functionality between all these components is done by CU only. Now let's move to the register. Now what are register actually? It works as a temporary memory. Registers are the temporary memory. It holds data and instruction for temporary basis. Okay, so register or processor register a small unit of data holding places. CPU uses register temporarily holds some important processing information during the time the processing is take place. CPU may store some part of data or some memory address or some instruction in the processor register. So in a if we want to store something for the temporary basis, we can do in the registers. Okay children, I hope you are getting my point. Let's move to the next slide. Next slide is about the storage unit. Let's see what is the meaning of the storage unit. Now computer is a kind of a machine in which we store data, in which we perform maximum type of things like processing, operations, many things we perform. So in computer many things we store also. So for that we need a storage unit. Now in computer we are having two types of storage unit. One is internal and another is external. So let's see what is the internal or external. Okay, so basically when we are talking about the storage unit means a place where we store data. Okay, data can be in a form of audio also, in a form of video also, anything. Okay, so it can be HD video, it can be normal video, anything can be. Okay, now storage unit is divided into two parts, primary and secondary. Now most of the time, which storage unit we use primary. So in this, many things come like RAM. Primary having two types of storage, RAM and ROM, random access memory and read only memory. Secondary storage devices are the external storage devices like pen drives, hard disks, memory chips. So all come in the category of secondary storage unit. Okay children, now let's discuss about the primary memory. Primary memory is of two types, RAM and ROM, children. Now let's, if before we start with RAM and ROM, let's understand that when we are storing something, when we store data on the CPU in the any memory place, so in which extension, in which category they used to store. So the smallest unit is bit when we store something. Okay, like when you take milk, it comes in liters. When we talk about water, it also comes in liter. When you talk about sugar, it comes in kg, gram. In this way, in the same manner, when we talk about memory, children, here we talk about bit, byte, kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, in this way. So bit is the smallest place, smallest unit of computer. In bit, only binary digit can be stored, like means 0 or 1. Okay children, so now what is byte here? 1 byte is equal to 8 bits. Okay, now 1 kilobytes is equal to 1024 bytes. So in this, these types of conversions, these types of units about the computer memory measurement is already given at the page number 5 of your book. You can check there. Okay, now let's talk about RAM and ROM. See children, in the random access memory, if we talk about RAM, random access memory, full form is random access memory. The memory cells can be accessed for information transfer from any desired random location. That is, the process of locating a word in memory is the same and requires an equal amount of memory, thus the name as random access. The main drawback of RAM memory is that it is a volatile memory. Now, RAM is a volatile memory. What is the meaning of volatile here? Volatile means power goes off, the content of RAM gets erased. So computer is a machine, it works on the power, it works on the battery. When battery discharge or we switch off the power button, so whatever stored in this RAM, it automatically gets erased. So this is a big disadvantage about the RAM. Now RAM chips in a computer, RAM is basically of two types, DRAM and SRAM. Now D stand for dynamic here and S stand for static here. Okay, now dynamic RAM, these are made up of transistor and capacitors. The amount of time taken to produce data required from memory from the start of access until the availability of data is called the memory access time. DRAM chips have access time ranging from 20 to 70 nanoseconds. Static RAM, these are made up of flip-flops, offer faster access times than DRAM. Mostly in our computer we use DRAM children, because it is easy to use or it is less expensive in comparison to the SRAM. SRAM is expensive more in comparison to DRAM. Now, DRAM is slow, SRAM is fast. DRAM we use as a primary storage, and SRAM we use when we need a specialization. If we need a if we want to store some specialized things, that time we use SRAM. Okay, so DRAM is made up of transistors and capacitors, that is why it is less expensive, and SRAM is made up of flip flop, that is why it is very much expensive. Okay, so okay, now at the end, ROM is also having many categories like we are having PROM, we are having EPROM, we are having EEPROM, and flash EEPROM, mask ROM. Now, what is ROM actually? Let's see that. As the name implies, read only memory is the memory until that perform the read operation only. So ROM is the part of that CPU in which only we can read the data. It does not have a write capability. This implies that the binary information stored in a ROM is made permanent during the hardware production of the unit and cannot be altered by writing different words into it. Hence, non-volatile. Whereas RAM is general purpose device whose content can be altered during the computational process. A ROM are restricted to reading words that are permanently stored within the unit. ROM are used for application in which it is known that the information never needs to be altered. For example, a monitor, programming controller, machine, etc. So, now let's talk about PROM. PROM, P stand for programmable ROM, also called OTP, one-time programmable. PROM is a user programmable memory in which information is burnt using the special equipment called ROM burner. Now, EPROM. EPROM is erasable programming ROM. In EPROM, one can program the memory chip and erase it many times as needed. The UV EPROM can take up to 20 minutes for erasing the EPROM contents. Now, EEPROM. Electrically erasable programmable program ROM. In EPROM is erased electrically, which is faster. Also, with EEPROM, selective bytes can be erased, unlike UV EPROM, which erases fully. Okay, so when we are talking about EPROM, in which we can erase the things, so it erases full things, everything it can be erased, but with the help in EEPROM, only selective things we can erase. Now, the next part of ROM is flash ROM. It is like a EEPROM, but it is very fast comparatively. The erasure of the entire content takes time than a second. It erases fully and not selectively. Okay. Last type of ROM you are having, mask ROM. Mask ROM refers to a kind of ROM in which contents are programmed by IC manufacturer. It is not a user programmable ROM. Okay, with this, your RAM and ROM content is finished. So let's talk about the cache memory. One word is also there in your book, that is cache memory. Now, what is cache memory? It's a special high-speed storage mechanism. It can either serve section of main memory or an independent high-speed storage device or even on CPU chip. Whenever some data is required, CPU first looks in the cache. If it is not there, if the data is found in the cache, CPU does not access memory, hence the process becomes very fast. So, cache is basically temporary storage device, temporary storage place. So first of all, if we want to search anything, we go to the cache memory. Most probably we always find things there only. Okay, so with this your primary devices we are ending. Let's see the secondary devices. Let's talk about the secondary device. Now one question arises here, why actually the secondary devices we need? It is used for storing large amount of data as compared to the primary. Now primary memory is always limited to the space. So if we want to increase the space of our CPU, of our computer, we can add the secondary devices. Okay, it is made for removing the limitation of primary storage. So when we talk about the primary memory, we most of the time talk about the RAM only. So RAM has some limitation too. RAM only works when the power is on. When power goes off, all the memory can be erased. Okay, so that's why we need a secondary device. So we are having hard drives, compact discs, DVDs, flash memory, Blu-ray discs. So these are the example of the secondary devices. Now hard disk can be internal, external also. So when we talk about the secondary memory, basically secondary memory is of two type. First is magnetic, second is optical, and third is flash memory. Okay, first we understand these three words, afterwards we will talk about these. Okay, now magnetic media means in which data is stored in the form of magnetized. Okay, and optical media is a place where data is stored in the form of light, and flash memory is a memory in which data is stored in a form of binary form, in a form of 0 or 1. Okay, so hard disks come in the category of magnetic media because in this data is stored in a form of magnetized form. Okay, one more thing come in the category of magnetic. If we talk about magnetic media, hard disk is coming in the category of magnetic, then floppy is also come in the magnetic media category. But these days you are not able to see floppy disks because when floppy disks were there in the time of 80s and 90s, these days very hardly you are able to see the floppy disks. Floppy disk is a kind of a secondary device in which we store data. Okay, now third is magnetic tape. Now magnetic tape is also come in the category of magnetic media only. So these two are not in the market these days. These are present only at the time of 80s and 90s. Okay, now let's talk about the optical media. Optical media is a media in which we store data in a form of light only, like CD, compact discs, CD, DVDs, Blu-ray disc, all come in the category of optical media. In this, data is stored in a form of light only. Data is stored in the form of light only. They are relatively cheap and have a storage capacity up to 700 MB. They are in the three main types. Now CDs in the market come in the three categories. Now CD, ROM, then CD R and CDRW. CD-ROM is compact disc read-only memory. This is used only to store information and cannot be used to store data. It is mainly used for CD distribution, software, games, ebooks. Okay, CDR is recordable. CDR means now you also can write something on that CD. CD-ROM is a category like you are having software CDs. When you buy software from the market, in those CDs you are not able to write anything. So that are called CD-ROM. It means compact disc in the read-only memory. You are not able to write something on that. Only you can read
things from that particular CD. Okay, CDR means in this you can write something according to your wish. CDRW, last category of CD is CDRW, means readable and writable. So rewritable. So if once you have read that CD, in the CDRW category you can write again and again according to your requirement. Okay, now last is Blu-ray disc. Now CD and DVDs having few limitations. So Blu-ray disc basically removes those limitations. Blu-ray disc is the optical disc storage media format. Its main uses are high definition video. Now high definition video means HD video. When you want to store the high definition HD video and data storage, that time we need Blu-ray disc in comparison to the CD and DVDs. The disc has the same dimension as the standard DVD or CD, while current optical disc technology such as DVD, DVD-R, DVD-RW and DVD-RAM rely on the red laser to read and write data. The new format uses blue violet laser instead, hence the name is Blu-ray. The benefit of using blue violet laser is that it has shorter wavelength than a red laser, which makes it possible to focus the laser spot with even a greater precision. Okay, this allows data to be packed more tightly and stored in the less space, so it's possible to fit more data on the disk even though it's the same size as the CD and DVD. Blu-ray disc of today are capable of storing up to 128 GB of data. Okay, now last component of your computer system is system bus. Children, system bus is an electronic pathway composed of connecting cables that connect the major components of computer system. Through system bus, data instruction are passed among the computer system components. What is the function of data bus? Data bus basically is a kind of mediator between the all the components. Like in the normal languages, in the normal world, what is the role of bus? To travel from one place to another. In the same manner, data bus plays a major role here in the components of the computer system. So input unit, output unit, CPU and other memory storage devices, when they want to communicate, when they want to move from one place to another, when they want to pass the data from one place to another, so basically that time they use data bus. Now bus is of three categories. Now bus is of three types. First is data bus. About this we have already discussed in the previous video. Second is control bus and third is address bus. Now data bus, data carrying part of a system bus. Now data bus is that place of system bus where with the help of this we are able to carry the data. Now control bus carry instructions, okay, where we have to send that data. Okay, control instruction carrying part of the system bus. And address bus, memory address carrying part of the system bus. Now data bus handles the data, address bus handles the address of that data, okay, destination and the starting address, and control bus basically handles the all the communication between the buses, okay, whether all the buses are doing right work or not. Okay, with this I am ending this video, children. So in the next video we are going to discuss more about this chapter. Thank you so much for attending this class. Sairam.